Welcome to Your Wealth. This Real Talk San Diego. We have Karen Cassino and myself, Ryan White. We have with us today Janita Wall, as well as Alisa Kerr, both here to talk about SecondSaturday.com. And before we get into that, Janita Wall, certified financial planner and forensic CPA, as well as Alisa Kerr, is a family law and estate planning attorney. And then later in the show, we're going to have Robert McFarlane, as well as Gata Osman on to go over additional details about the Second Saturday program. Janita, tell us a little bit about the Second Saturday program. And again, the website is secondsaturday.com.
Yeah, so Second Saturday is a divorce workshop. It covers the legal, the financial, and the emotional parts of divorce. It started here in San Diego. We're just finishing up our 28th year.
28th year. And you started it.
I started it. Yeah, I was just a little girl then when I started
it. You were 10,
yes,
right?
I was 10. Yeah, and so we're finishing up our 28th year. And it's at the original flagship one is at MiraCosta College in Cardiff. Mm-hmm. And it costs $45 to attend. And about 3 years ago, we started spreading these around the country. And we're now in about 125 different locations. Four of those locations are here in San Diego.
So there's four different locations for the Second Saturday workshop in San Diego.
That is correct. In San Diego. Yeah, the flagship location is at MiraCosta College in Cardiff.
Okay.
And then there's one in Mission Valley. There's one in East County. And then there's one up in Temecula.
And Lisa, you do one in Mission Valley, right?
Yes, at DeVry University.
Got it. And if it's not obvious, when is it hosted?
Let me think. I think it's on the second Saturday of every month. Yes.
Got it. Yeah. And you mentioned very briefly what you get out of it, but who is there? What are the people that are there?
So the people who attend, are about half of the people who come are just thinking of divorce.
Okay.
The other half are someplace in the process, often at the beginning stages. The earlier you come, the better prepared you are for what's coming. So the people who are then instructing are an attorney who talks about the legal aspects of divorce, a therapist talking about the emotional aspects, and then a financial person, usually myself, mm-hmm. talking about the money issues. And then the final speaker after the break is a mediator who talks about mediation and alternatives to going to court.
And that's really who we have with us today. We have representatives of those four flavors, so to speak, of speakers there, of course, from San Diego, that are going to be at the Second Saturday in either Mission Valley or MiraCosta, as you
right.
just described.
Yeah. Now, some people ask me, do you go around the country and do all of these on the Second Saturday? And my answer is no, I'm not Santa Claus. I can't be all around the country all at the same time.
Okay.
But we have people in across the country who are doing these. And you can get that information through secondsaturday.com. Just click on Find a Workshop.
secondsaturday.com. Okay, so that's the website, secondsaturday.com. Again, secondsaturday.com. Now let's talk about what information they will receive when they leave, and you know, an understanding of the process, I'm sure they're gonna receive. And frankly, I think it may be unique to really understand and get some preliminary understanding if the grass is really going to be greener.
That's exactly right. Yeah, as I said, about half the people who are just thinking about
right.
divorce are there. Half the people there are just thinking about divorce. And very often after they hear about the legal aspects, about the emotional aspects, about the financial aspects,
uh-huh.
they leave saying, I think I'll go home and work on my marriage, because they thought divorce might be a solution, but they find out that it's just a whole nother bunch of problems.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. That's a really interesting concept to, test drive to some degree. I mean, I get it. You're not actually getting divorced, but you get to really potentially lay out what the finances would be like, which is a much lengthier conversation,
yes.
but a very top level aspect of what the finances could be like. Or the custody situation could be like if
yeah.
you go through with this. And I would think in many circumstances, the grass is not greener. And there is a point, I would think, during the divorce process where going back is not an option.
Yeah, yeah.
The bridge is burned at some point
yeah.
through
yes.
the divorce,
yeah.
I would think.
Yes, and you know, divorce is not a great solution because at best you're going to end up with only half of what you had before
a
couple.
Okay, at best,
and that's
yes.
the best case scenario.
Okay.
And if you fight about it, the attorneys are going to end up with everything and you're going to end up with nothing.
Got it.
Yeah.
Got
so
it.
People learn about the alternatives that there are for going through full-blown, I'm going to take my spouse for everything he's worth, because you're not going to get that, and the attorneys are going to get it all.
Well, and there's no pot of gold at the end of the rainbow like there is with a litigation case. You're suing somebody. Maybe they're going to pay you money, pay for your legal fees. Your legal fees are coming out of your pot that you're dividing up.
Oh,
and
absolutely.
I think a lot of people don't really think about that. They think that the legal fees are going to come out of somewhere, but it comes out of the money that you're dividing up.
Yeah,
so anything you give to, I'm a forensic accountant that does divorce. Janita mostly does consulting now, but anything you give to us is money that's not there for you or your children. That's what happens.
And there's another person who's got their hand out sometimes, and that's Uncle Sam.
Yeah,
and
always.
We had one woman who came, and she was toward the end of the process, and she was about to acquire the rental property from her husband, settle with him to pay him money for it because she liked the rental income. And once we took a look at it, actually they had refinanced it over the years and depreciated it down to a nub where the taxes when she sold it would be far more than the equity that she was getting. So she would have been underwater, and she was paying her husband for the privilege of taking it. So she quickly changed her mind on that.
Well, a benefit of a divorce financial consultant, right?
Yes,
which
exactly.
is your job, so to speak, right? A divorce financial consultant.
Yeah.
So one more time, go through the four main flavors of professionals that are there at Second Saturday Speaking.
Yeah, so we vet our attorneys very carefully. They have to have people with years of experience, people who can actually speak in English and not just in legalese. That's very important, because when you're there, you are, no matter where you are in the process, you're in an emotional state, and you need people to simplify it. Then we have a therapist who talks, and again, that's somebody who can walk you through how it's going to be for you and your family, and what you can do to make the impact less on the children, how you can negotiate with your spouse from a win-win situation and stance. And then I, as a financial person, walk people through what I call the 12 financial pitfalls of divorce, to keep them from falling into those pitfalls, you know, of not having the paperwork, of not considering important assets, of not getting good advice.
Makes sense. So again, the seminar is Second Saturday, and the website is secondsaturday.com. That's the website, secondsaturday.com. Now, one of those attorneys that has been vetted, as you mentioned here, is Alisa Kerr, and her website is Kerr Law, K-E-R-R, Law, and she runs Second Saturday out of Mission Valley. Right?
Correct, yep.
And so family law attorney as well as estate planning, but down there you fulfill the role as family law attorney.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so go through us briefly about, you know, your session down there at Second Saturday and what you cover.
Well, so like Janita described, my session is run a lot like hers as the flagship. And so I'm a territory of the original Second Saturday. And so as the attorney, my element is, of course, to focus on the law, the legal aspect of the divorce process. And like Janita said, try to break it down into English so people understand what it is they're getting into, and to determine if the grass is going to be greener or not.
Right.
One of the things I tell everybody that comes to Second Saturday is that I am not a proponent of divorce, but there are, you know, I think the last statistic I read was there is a divorce filed almost every 40 seconds in the United States or something like that, right? So it happens.
Yeah.
And it's an option for people. But you're either working on your marriage or you're working on your divorce. But they're both work. And to get a divorce is a legal process. And it affects every aspect of your life. It affects your finances. It affects your family. It affects where you live. Affects everything. And so it's very important that before, hopefully before you start the process, you get an overview of what it actually is. And so, you know, what I try to do is describe for them what the legal process is so they know what the steps are. And then most importantly, I want to tell them how to navigate that process. Because, you know, from reality TV and all of our buddies, we think we know what divorce looks like. But the truth is that there's, you shouldn't get your legal advice from the Real Housewives, okay? I tell my client, like, please,
what?
Don't do that. Yeah. But, you know, but there are actually different options for getting through the process. And so I make sure to educate the attendees about those different options so that if they decide to go through the process, they can pick the method that's best for them. And like you said, you know, the divorce process can seriously burn some bridges. And so my advice is, particularly if you're co-parenting, which is going to last forever, then you want to start with the least aggressive means and try to, you know, keep as much money in your pockets as possible and keep as much peace as possible. So I tell them those options and so that they can pick the best one for them. Don't hire a wrecking ball to do what a hammer can do. But don't pick up a hammer if you need a wrecking ball for your divorce. See what I'm saying? And then the last thing that I make sure to educate them on are the basics of the law. So the main issues are child custody and support, spousal support, and then property division. And again, that's as a complete basics 101, but the point of that is that I want our attendees to know, hey, the law is the law is the law. It doesn't change for anybody. And so you can either go into the process and spend all the money in your pot fighting to get the same result that you'll get by basically through agreement, because the law is the law is the law. And so you need to have somebody that you trust that can advise you on what the law is so that you can make a good decision for you and your family and not go through that whole battle and burn those bridges.
Well, you mentioned that we shouldn't get our advice from the Real Housewives, but you also shouldn't get divorce advice from your friends that you talk to over breakfast one morning either, because every divorce is different. The law is a law, right? But every divorce is different. And so, and I, as you know, I'm a forensic accountant that does divorce work, and we get a lot of people that says, well, my friend said that she didn't have to do this, or she got lifetime support, or my friend got, and they just don't know that their case is different than their friends. And really going to a workshop like this and meeting professionals that are in this field that want to help make it easier and more efficient is where you need to go, because your friend that you know, play tennis with or just go out with is not going to probably give you great advice.
And while they may have the best intentions for you, like you said, it may not be the best advice. And that's what I think is so valuable about the workshop. And I'm divorced, and I wish I would have known about the workshop before I went through the process, because it does give you that realistic overview of, it's sort of the crystal ball, I say. It gives you a realistic overview of the process and what to expect afterwards. As Janita said, as you know, your best outcome is half. Nobody is stoked to get half, but that's the best you can do. Nobody walks out of divorce being like, woo, I got half everything. Nobody is happy to get half, but half is your best bet. I mean, it's the best you can do. And so if you're not getting good advice and you're going into the process with unrealistic expectations because a Real Housewife got three houses or your buddy got lifetime support or whatever, that may not be what applies, or probably isn't what applies to your situation and how the law is applied to your facts. So it is important to get good advice, and then also to make sure that you're working with professionals to get the best outcome. Because even though no one's stoked with half, you can still get the best half that you can get for what it is you want to accomplish. You know, we want to make sure that when people are negotiating a settlement, they understand what their tax consequences are. They understand what their tax benefits are. You know, we can structure different things to try to get our clients the best potential half of their half. You know, so that's the objective.
We're talking with Elisa Kerr. Her website is kerrlaw.net, kerrlaw.net. We're talking about Second Saturday, and the website for the seminar is secondsaturday.com. That's the website, secondsaturday.com. And you said something in there that I thought was really unique, is realistic expectations. Because once that's established, the method of going through and how much you have left to split seems like all falls out of that. And I would think that one of the best things to come out of the Second Saturday seminar is a top part of realistic expectations. Now, I don't mean you every financial aspect is described there, but the beginning, the peak, so to speak, about realistic expectations is something that I would expect would come out of that.
Yeah. Hopefully, yes. I mean, that's what we're trying to do. We want the objective is for people to be able to leave our seminar, our workshop, and have a greater understanding of the reality. And like I said, kind of that crystal ball of this is what's probably going to happen, and this is probably going to be my outcome. That kind of takes away some of the fear. It takes away some of the, you know, what would the word be, the fantasy, I guess, of it. And, you know, allows them to make a good decision, and get good help to help them whichever way they decide to go.
Well, and the reality that if you're dividing everything in half, that you're not probably going to be able to live the way you did before. And that's probably the biggest hard pill for anyone to swallow, right? And they'll leave the workshop knowing that that's just not going to be, they are not going to be living probably the way that they did before.
Unless they get custody of the printing press in the basement where they can turn out more money. That's absolutely correct.
Right. So that's the first big reality, right, that they need to know. And then I think, too, just knowing that you have to disclose information and you have to tell each other what's there so you know what to divide. I mean, that, frankly, is the hardest thing I think that we all deal with in divorce, is probably why they get so expensive, is when people are not telling the truth or they're not disclosing what it is they have. So I'm sure you go through that and say you have to disclose, here's the forms you have to fill out, but you've got to let people know what it is you have so we know what to divide. If we don't, then Janita and I have to get involved and try and figure out where things are, and that's frankly where it gets expensive.
Yes.
Well, that's a good segue, Janita. In addition to running Second Saturday, your practice is a divorce financial consulting practice. Mm-hmm. Give us some idea of what that is.
Okay. So just to segue into that, it's not, when you go through a divorce, it's not pitting one person against the other. It's the two of them against the problem of how to divvy these things up. So that's where I come in, is often people will come to see me before they've even talked to their spouse about divorce, because they're thinking about it and they know what they'd be getting out of. What they're not really sure of is what they'd be getting into. So that's what we talk about, is some of the things that, how their life might look after the divorce, what they might expect, how they might go about it, and even more importantly, the things that they can do to be better prepared if they do go through the divorce, so that they're in a better position to move forward. I also work with people who are someplace in the process, helping them make those really important decisions. Should I keep the house? Should we sell the house? Should I let him buy me out of the house? How do we divvy up the retirement plan? How do I come up? Should I trade retirement for the house equity? How are we going to pay off these debts? What are we going to do about the business he has? All those kinds of things. And then I also work in mediation with people. I am trained as a mediator, but I don't do mediation. But I work with people who are trying to figure out together what their money is that they have to divide up, or how two budgets are going to work, or work with one or the other on important financial issues.
To find more information about Janita and Second Saturday, go to the website, which is secondsaturday.com. Again, the website, secondsaturday.com, as well as Elisa, also a presenter there at Second Saturday, but her website is additionally kerlaw.net, kerrlaw.net. That's the website, kerlaw.net. Now we're going to invite Robert McFarlane, as well as Gada Osman, to come on up and tell us about their portion of the Second Saturday
seminar. Thank you, Janita.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
So in mediation, there also are real estate issues that come up. Janita mentioned that there are sometimes people need to know whether they can stay in the home, if they can afford to buy something or rent, and certainly having a real estate professional such as you help in the mediation process to give them an idea of what they can afford and what kind of rentals are out there. You help Janita and Robert and the participants that are going through mediation. What kinds of things can you do to help them when they're going through that?
Well, it certainly plays well into, is the grass really greener, right? Because, you know, as you mentioned, things are being split in half. Generally, if the house split in half. You know, can't afford, or it doesn't make sense for the
3,000 to 4,000 square foot home. So generally those are downsized into 2,000 square feet home, or somebody goes out and rents. But providing information. Process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's good to have professionals. We've been talking with them. Brian's one of them I know that helps. That just have kind of an understanding way that they deal with people when they're going through a divorce, because it's a tough time. It's very emotional. People have to leave their home. You know, to have people that are tuned into the realities of what they're dealing with is good. So now we have two new guests here. We've got Robert McFarlane, who is a family law mediator. Speaks at Second Saturday, mm-hmm. as well as has his own mediation practice in Encinitas, and Gada Osman, who is a PhD licensed marriage and family therapist with a practice in Encinitas, and you both participate in Second Saturday. We'll start with you, Robert. You are in charge of the men's side of Second Saturday, right? We didn't kind of mention it, but what Janita was talking about is what the women attend from 8:30 to 1:30 every second Saturday. You are in charge of the men's side, which is still called right. Second Saturday, right?
Yes. The men's workshop, or the reason we have them in different rooms is basically for comfort and candor. The men feel more comfortable and are more candid in addressing their issues mm-hmm. without women in the room, and the same is true with the women. And so at the North County campus in Cardiff, we have two. They both start at 8:30 in the morning, and they're both done every second Saturday. And they cover basically the same things. Some people think, well, the men are hearing something different than the women. They're not. The law in California is gender neutral. So the information is the same. It's just simply for the purposes of people being able to feel more comfortable in discussing their issues.
Well, we've talked a little bit already about the options that people have available. What are the options? I mean, they if they decide to get a divorce, what are their options?
Well, they can do it in court, as we're used to hearing about, where they hire attorneys and go to court. They can do it in collaborative divorce, which is a whole other approach, and they can do it in mediation. And they hear about all three approaches in the workshop. So many people have either poor or little information, or they have bad information. And they come in with unreasonable expectations, unfounded worries, unfounded concerns. And many people have no idea about mediation, and they have no idea about collaborative divorce, both of which are options that people have. An analogy I sometimes uses, consider that you had a sore shoulder and you went to see an orthopedist, and the orthopedist said to you, well, we can do three things. I can give you an exercise and stretching regime that usually fixes that issue that you have, or I can give you a cortisone injection, or I can operate on your shoulder. Now, which would you choose first, and which would you choose last? In the options that we just discussed, mediation is the first. It's something that is very non-invasive. It costs about one-tenth of what it would cost to go to court. It takes a few meetings instead of a few years. And collaborative divorce is something in between mediation and litigation. And there are certain people who would benefit from that. That would be more in line with their needs. So that litigation really should be a last resort. It is, and when people learn about the options that they have, it's one of the reasons why they feel a lot more comfortable. People coming into Second Saturday, I mean, you can see the stress. You can see the pain is almost palpable. I watch them walking in, and then I watch them walking out, and it's like two different groups. And it's the effect of knowledge, it's effect of putting to rest some of their fears. Some of them come in, they're afraid they're going to be a bag lady. They're or they're thinking that they're going to get lifetime support or that they're going to pay lifetime support. These things aren't realistic. They learn about how the process works, and there is a comfort level in the knowledge that it is not as frightening as they thought. They usually come out also feeling that it's more complicated than they thought.
We're talking with Robert McFarlane. He is a family law mediator. His phone number is 760-753-3766. One more time, 760-753-3766. Talking about the mediation process as well as his role in the Second Saturday seminars. That website again is secondsaturday.com. Now, Robert, one of the things that you mentioned to me that I found most unique in this empowering of information is that the idea of husband or wife sneaking off and getting more information by attending this seminar than perhaps the other one does is completely false. In a perfect world, you'd want both to go get all the information so that hopefully a lot of the fighting doesn't have to happen.
Spot on. The more both parties know, the better it is for both of them.
Yeah.
An awful lot of the problems in divorce come from a lack of knowledge of people's rights and obligations. Mm-hmm. And they're acting out in ways that they would never act out if they understood the situation. Mm-hmm. Ways that are actually counter to their own interest.
Well, a lot of it is emotional, too. A lot of it is, as you said, pain and emotion, and they haven't been to Gada Osman. And we'll switch over to you, Gada. You have a practice in Encinitas. You also participate in Second Saturday. Tell us a little bit about what you tell the participants when they come in and what your part of it is.
Yeah, so as Robert mentioned, the stress is clearly there. The palpable pain, as you put it, is clearly there. And one of the first things that I do in Second Saturday is that I talk about that and acknowledge that. So I ask, who here feels overwhelmed? Every hand goes up. Right? Everybody feels overwhelmed in terms of the details, but everybody also feels overwhelmed emotionally. Divorce is ranked as one of the highest stressors in life, second only to death of a spouse. And actually, there can be very complicated divorces and situations that are involved in divorce that make it potentially a top stressor. And yet at the same time, people in that emotional state of feeling a great deal of grief and loss because ultimately they're losing a marriage, they're losing a relationship with someone who they might have at some point in life considered their best friend. Who goes into a marriage thinking that it might end in divorce? Pretty much nobody. So that's a huge piece. There is all that grief. There's the anxiety about the future. There's the complications of figuring out all sorts of details along the way. And yet somehow people in that very precarious emotional state are supposed to be making decisions that are very practical and will determine circumstances for potentially the rest of their lives. And so how they are able to do that, how they're able to approach that ultimately is related directly to how they're able to function emotionally. A lot of the time in talking about therapy and talking about divorce, there's often the idea that the only thing on the issue is marriage therapy. And that couples will come into marriage therapy. So marriage therapy, ultimately, both people are trying to work on the marriage. But at the same time, one of the really important pieces of working emotionally through a divorce and therefore being able to work on the practical parts of a divorce is individual therapy, the emotions that each individual is dealing with, as well as other aspects of working together as a couple, such as, for example, discernment therapy, the idea that what is there to explore as a marriage is potentially coming to a close. So all those are things that I talk about at Second Saturday. The emotional pieces, how to ultimately move forward in terms of seeking professional support, as well as then emotional aspects that affect other people related in the marriage. Of course, the prime one being kids, if the couple has kids, but not just kids, relations with other people, a lot of different shifts that are occurring at that time.
We're talking with Gada Osman. It's G-H-A-D-A. Osman is O-S-M-A-N. And your website is GadaOsman.com. And you have a practice in Encinitas. As I've mentioned, I am in the divorce world, and I always tell people the worst use of your time and money is to work out your pain and resentment through the process and through me. Mm-hmm. You know, I want to punish them. I want to, mm-hmm. you want to work with you to get through some of those issues so that you can work together towards getting solutions, right?
Absolutely. As you mentioned in the earlier part of the show, it's the same pot that everything is coming out of. And so it can be very easy for couples or individuals within the marriage to assume that, well, I really need to save that money for the legal aspects, for the financial aspects, and of course you do. And at the same time, working on the emotional can really save you quite a bit down the road in the other two directions. Because by having that piece be figured out, then now when you're meeting, for example, in mediation to talk about how to divide this or that, you're really only focused on the actual practical issues on the table, not all the emotions behind them.
And I was looking at your website. You have some pretty interesting different modes of therapy. You've got something called EMDR and yoga therapy.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But tell me a little bit about those.
So I do traditional talk therapy, and at the same time, I also engage in therapies that work more on a subconscious level. So you and I can sit and talk, and I can tell you my story, and I can keep telling you my story, and the first or second time, I feel maybe pretty good that you're hearing more, that I'm being listened to and I'm being heard. But as time goes on, I'm telling the same story, I'm repeating the same things, and in order for me to move forward, I might need to come in a way that's less habitual. So yoga therapy, EMDR therapy, art therapy, these are all ways of accessing deeper levels of emotion and bringing about change through non-habitual ways that ultimately are what we can call more primary. So what I mean by that is emotions live in the body. So we're kind of used to that, right? We talk about butterflies in the stomach, a tightness in the chest, tension in the shoulders. We know that that's all connected to emotions. But when we try to work with them, a lot of the time we talk about them. But how about instead actually working with them directly? If I'm feeling tension in my shoulders, how about I work with that directly using the body, using yoga therapy, for example? Using EMDR therapy, that's a type of trauma therapy that's been approved as one of the top methods of trauma therapy by the VA, so even in dealing with veterans. And anything that occurs in life that affects us deeply emotionally is a trauma. And of course, divorce is one such example.
Again, we're talking with Gada Osman. She is a therapist in Encinitas. Her website is GadaOsman.com, GHADAOsman.com. So back to Second Saturday, that you deal with a lot of the emotion. I know I work with Robert in mediation with a lot of the people that end up going through there and dealing with their emotions, you know, collectively. It really, everyone needs to know that if you go to Second Saturday and get the information, what you'll find out is that we all work together to help people get through divorce as painlessly as we can. And so the professionals are talking with each other. If Robert's working with someone that's going through mediation, he'll refer them over to GADA if they need some help or if they need some finances. So tell us a little bit about your practice there in Encinitas.
Well, I've been doing litigation and mediation since the late 70s. 1994, I shut down my litigation practice and I do only mediation. Second Saturday, I wanted to mention that if somebody is interested in Second Saturday at the MiraCosta campus, the best way to find out about it is to Google MiraCosta Divorce Workshop. It'll take you right to the women's and the men's and you find out what room they're in. You don't have to pre-register, you just show up. They both start at the same time.
So they just go to MiraCosta College at 8:30 in the morning, a little bit before,
yeah.
And they go
Cardiff campus.
It's off
of Manchester.
And I hear that it's room 201 for the women.
It's usually 307, but it changes every once in a while.
And they don't have to pre-register. And the cost is very, very minimal, I think. It's between $25 and $45 for the whole morning. Mm-hmm. So the cost is small. You just go that day, show up, and you go to those rooms and go to the conference.
It's not an accident that it covers financial, legal, and emotional. Those three things are majordomos in it. It's just huge. When I was doing litigation, I used to feel like I was about 40% attorney and 60% shrink, because the emotional component of divorce is huge. The legal component of frequently the tail is wagging the dog. And so it's very important to be addressing the emotional issue. Also, Janita Wall is one of the most talented and extraordinary resources I've ever run across in my profession. She has been helping me deal with clients for about 20 some odd years. And she is, I consider her world class. We are very blessed to have her in our backyard. The as far as what mediation, one of the common misconceptions about mediation is that you have to be getting along. You do not need to be getting along. In fact, the people that aren't getting along are the ones that need mediation the most. They are the ones that are going to spend six figures each getting divorced. If they're getting along, that's wonderful, but it's not a prerequisite at all. It's a process that approaches divorce as a series of problems rather than an adversarial one like the litigation process. The parties control their own destiny. As I point out to my clients, in this process, you rule. So you are determining your own destiny. You are the husband and wife and the mother and the father are determining what happens with the kids, not somebody, a judge in a black robe that doesn't know their children, doesn't love their children, and is going to be guessing at what's best for them. Everything is done out of court and completely confidentially, as opposed to a court divorce, which is completely public. Not only does all of your finances, all your income, all your assets and debts, but the issues of your marriage, all of this stuff is public record. So mediation allows people an opportunity to control their destiny, to do it privately at about one-tenth or less of what it would cost to do the same thing in court.
We're talking with Robert McFarlane, who is a family law mediator. His phone number is area code 760-753-3766. Practice there in Encinitas. Mm-hmm. One last question for both of you. We haven't talked about the impact on the kids. Mm-hmm. And why it's important to work together towards a mediated or an agreeable settlement. What's the impact on the kids, Gata?
Yeah, the impact on children with divorce is huge. And I think sometimes people can underestimate it, especially if they have older children. People will think that for teenage children, for adult children, it's not such a big deal. But even for kids that age, this is a shift for them. They have known their parents together pretty much all of their lives, and now here's something that's changing, that's a major transition, let alone with smaller children, younger children, where we're really talking about setting up a template for how the two parents will now co-parent in the future. The smoother the split, and the more that the parents can really know how to interact with each other throughout the divorce process, throughout mediation potentially, the more successful they are at being functional co-parents for their children moving forward.
Those are issues you work with them in mediation too,
The correct? Difference between dealing with a couple that have children and not is huge. Mm-hmm. It is absolutely huge. When I'm dealing with a couple that don't have children, I know that they're going to save a lot of money. They're going to close a chapter of their life in a more evolved way, but they may never see each other again. Mm-hmm. When I'm dealing with a couple that have children, I know that they're going to be interacting with each other because of their relationship with the children for as long as both of them are on the planet. The way they get their divorce is going to affect those children. It's going to, and as pointed out, it's going to affect them regardless of the age. I talk about adult children being affected, and I see the parents out in the audience nodding. They know how affected their 30-year-old can be by their divorce. But the children are, when I'm working with a couple that have children, I know that the way this couple is doing their divorce is going to affect the childhood of those children. It's going to affect the kind of people they become, the kind of mothers and fathers they become, the kind of spouses they attract. That is going to affect the parenting of this couple's grandchildren. And likewise, the kind of parenting that the grandchildren get is going to affect the kind of people they become, the kind of parents they become, which is going to affect the life of the great-grandchildren and the great-great-great-grandchildren and all the people who are affected by how those people turned out. it's a sea of humanity. So when I'm working with a couple that have children, I realize that there is an absolute huge audience of people that are going to be affected by how these people do this. Are they modeling empathy, understanding, compassion, maybe even forgiveness? Or are they modeling greed, anger, revenge? The process of mediation tends to tap into the light in all of us. And I did litigation for 18 years, and I watched it tap into the dark side. The two processes are like night and day. And the effect it has on children, I believe children are the biggest beneficiaries of the process, the next generation and generations into the future.
Well, that's some spectacular insight into the divorce process, and even more specifically, you know, the mediation process. It is amazing to identify the length or in which you identified that it goes through it, mm-hmm. several generations there. To get a hold of Robert McFarlane, Family Law Mediator, his phone number is 760-753-3766. That's the number, 760-753-3766. Or the website, of course, is secondsaturday.com. He's there. Gada Osman, her website is GadaOsman.com, GadaOsman.com. Also can be found through secondsaturday.com, as well as Janita Wall and Elisa Kerr. Lisa Kerr's website is kerrlaw.net, kerrlaw.net. And Janita, of course, through secondsaturday.com. I want to thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
Until next month.